This is the last session of this conference, and I'm honored to have our second keynote speaker, Lieutenant General Moshe Ya'alon, former chief of the General Staff of the IDF, including during the war on Palestinian terrorism in the Second Intifada, a former minister, former Minister of Defense until recently, served a lifelong career in the public service of national security of Israel. So, without further ado, Bobby.
Thank you, Gilad. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Everyone is now engaged with Jerusalem, and I'm going to talk about Iran. Using my personal experience, going back to the 90s, serving as the head of intelligence, 95 to 98, and then on as the Israeli IDF general staff, deputy chief of staff and chief of staff, dealing with this challenge of the Iranian nuclear capability, and of course in my former capacities as a minister. And we have to look to the Iranian challenge in the backdrop of the failure of diplomacy of the North Korean issue. It's quite a spectacular failure. And for sure, according to my experience, you can't use diplomacy without leverages. Leverages to include, of course, political leverages, economic leverages, and military leverages. And the Iranian case, actually, is more dangerous than the North Korean threat. The North Koreans don't have any aspiration for hegemony, even in Asia. They don't have an idea to export any kind of revolution, which is a combination of religious ideology and a political strategy. And from the Iranian point of view, we have a regime since 1979 with the idea to export the revolution, to gain hegemony in our region, the Middle East, and beyond. Going back to President Ahmadinejad, 18 pages letter to President Bush, is unbelievable. The idea to impose the Islamic, Shia Islamic way, even by challenging the great Satan, America, and this is an aspiration beyond imagination. And unfortunately, when we deal with the deal, the JCPOA, they're quite successful, looking to their ability to get rid of political isolation, including economic sanctions, not being threatened anymore by any military option today because of the deal. And of course, the ability to gain hegemony in the region, dominating Tehran, of course, Shia government in Baghdad, Hezbollah in Beirut, Houthis in Yemen, in Sana'a, and now their activities in Syria. Right? Successful strategy. And this is because, what I claim, a Western weakness. And this is the case, and this is the case that I would like to talk about. Actually, the Iranian aspiration to gain a military nuclear capability is part of this policy in which the nuclear weapon will immune them from any external attack. Bearing in mind Muammar Gaddafi's poor experience when he had to give up its military nuclear project, at the end he was toppled. Saddam Hussein topic before. They believe that the nuclear project will be the way to immune the regime and its own activities by having this kind of nuclear umbrella. They don't hesitate to talk about using the military nuclear capability, as even Afsan Jami said that Israel is one bomb state. And they might use the weapons, the nuclear weapons by proxies, it might be. But no doubt that the vision is to acquire military nuclear capability. And this, they think in a very long way of thinking. They're not in a hurry. And then they face the challenge of 2013. They had the time to manipulate, to negotiate, to get a very convenient deal, for them it's a very good deal at the end, which allowed them to keep what they believe in, which is the indigenous capability to produce a bomb. It is one of the principles going back to the Shihab project. I was at the head of the intelligence at that time. And they insisted not to get missiles from North Korea or from former Soviet Union states. They wanted to have the indigenous capability to produce a missile which will be able to embrace or to adopt a military nuclear warhead. And they went through reverse engineering projects in order to be able to produce it by themselves. And this is the case with the military nuclear. Not to get a bomb from someone else, from North Korea, or from Pakistan, to be able to produce it by themselves. And that's the time. Nevertheless, going back to the beginning of the exposure of the military nuclear project in Iran, I believe that we were the first Israeli intelligence community to identify it. It was in the 90s. When we started to talk about the nuclear project, not as a civilian one, but as a military one. It took us 2 years to convince our American counterpart that this is a military project. And later on, the European intelligence agencies came on board with it. And then we failed the critical dialogue, led by European countries, with the idea to actually to promote Iranian moderation and reform, to tame Iran. That was the idea. I quote it from the mission of the critical dialogue. And they failed. And along the way, actually, the Iranians cheated. The exposure of Natanz wasn't made by IAEA. And it was a clear violation of the NPT. And it was exposed by intelligence agencies. Later on, Fordo. It was not exposed by IAEA or by the Iranians themselves. Why do you have to cheat? Why do you have to put these underground facilities for centrifuge enrichment? And for change, which is an open issue. IAEA didn't have the access to get into Fachin. I spoke about it with Amano. But it was after the American decision to go to bilateral negotiations. And he was not so determined to get into Fachin, which was a smoking gun. But what we witnessed immediately after 9/11, American offensive going to Afghanistan, then to Iraq, and the main question among rogue elements in the Middle East in 2003, after Operation Iraqi Freedom, was who might be targeted next. At that time, Muammar Gaddafi of Libya decided to give up his military nuclear project without a single shot. And Khamenei decided to suspend the military nuclear project. For how long? For about a year and a half. When he decided to renew the project, then he realized that the United States, 2005, had lost its political stomach to go on with offensive. We have to learn the lesson. So we have leverages, even upon this regime, what regime? And from 2005 and on, actually, we witnessed the activities. My retired as Chief of General Staff in 2005, the Iranians didn't have a single centrifuge. Going back to politics in 2009, Natanz, Fordu, ongoing research and development to have better centrifuges using some external know-hows and so forth. We meet this determination to acquire military nuclear capability. In 2010, I had the opportunity to travel to Egypt. Why? Because the United States actually tried to have a UN Security Council resolution regarding sanctions upon this whole regime. And Russia and China were not on board. Prime Minister Netanyahu traveled to Moscow to convince Putin. I traveled to Beijing. It was quite easy to convince them. I said that I brought with myself some intelligence materials. And at the end saying, you know, it looks like a duck, it swims like a duck, flight like a duck. It is a duck. You can't talk about civilian project with certain evidence. It proved to be military project. And the June 2010 UN Security Council resolution was approved anonymously without any veto. But we identify contradictory interests, to include European economic interest in Iran, Chinese economic interest in Iran, Russian certain interest in Iran. It was not so easy to get all of them on board. Nevertheless, we believe at that time that there is a way to convince Khomeini to give up the military nuclear project. A strategy consists of four elements: political isolation, crippling economic sanctions, credible military option, and because of the three, the regime fears from facing eternal uprising. And I claim that it worked. Actually, the fact that Khamenei decided to come to the table to negotiate bilaterally with a great Satan, America, it was for him, he had to use certain phrases like drinking the poisoning chat or flexible heroism to be engaged with a great Satan. But he came to the table on his knees. Why? Because his economic expert told him that Iran might not be able to survive economically. That's for a year and a half, if they will go on with these activities, because especially of the economic sanctions and the fear from the other elements. But when they were sitting on the table, at the beginning, clandestine meetings in Oman, which we understood, although we were not out of it, we haven't been told about it, between Americans and Iranians, and of course the beginning of the P5+1 engagement, but the bilateral negotiations were very important. At the end of the process, it felt like the Americans came on their knees and not Iran. I believe that in the academia, in the academic universities, teaching negotiations, it's a very good example of a superpower with all the good cards coming to the table to deal with someone who is very weak, and the weaker party gain what they wanted by using the bazaar element of negotiating and bargaining. And for Iran, it was a great release today. So anyhow, it's a very bad day. I'm sure that we could have be able to get more. And the discussion here was about the American position at the beginning of the negotiation and how the negotiation had ended. You know, you can't count it to the table as a party like the United States and sending Panetta to explain why the military option is so bad. You should have a credible military option. I still remember his chart. Five elements to explain why the military option is so bad. This is the way to come to the paper.
Doing it in Savannah.
And in the end, of course, we were furious. We were furious. First of all, because of the dead deal regarding the nuclear project. But ignoring the other activities, which are still relevant. Proliferation of arms and terror all over. Hard evidence on a daily basis. For us is a Hezbollah shipment from Iran to Hezbollah, shipment of weapons, financing the military wing of Hamas, sharing know-how how to manufacture and to produce better rockets and missiles in Lebanon, in Gaza, unmanned air vehicles. Clear evidence. It was endured in the deal. The missile project. At the last minute, the Iranians brought this issue to the table to shorten the period for the validity of the deal regarding, or the agreement, or the resolution regarding the missiles project. Unbelievable. Unbelievable. And in order not to be the spoiler of the party regarding the deal, which had become one of the Obama administration pillar of foreign policy achievement, not to challenge Iran on this issue. For us, it was a disaster. That's why we claim it's a very, very bad deal. Now, what should be done now? The Iranians are still determined to acquire military nuclear capability, for sure. It's part of the vision, it's part of the strategy. They haven't given up with this idea. But as I mentioned, even with this, I would say, even apocalyptic messianic ideology, ready to sacrifice, as a sacrifice, regarding the sanctions, regarding other activities, they were ready to sacrifice in order to be able to reach the nuclear capability, in order to go on with all activities. But at the end, if they reach the dilemma whether to go on with the rogue activities or to survive, like it happened actually successfully in 2013, I claim again the choice of Khamenei, his successor, will be survivability. And I believe that the only way to convince Iran of giving up the idea of the military nuclear project is to bring them back to this kind of dilemma. I believe this is true. Now, in order to make it, first of all, you should demonstrate determination. Not just by dealing with Iran. I claim is that if you don't demonstrate determination, illustrating red line to Bashar al-Assad, regarding the use of chemical weapons against his own civilians. And in the last meeting, in the last minute, using the U.S. U-turn, like Obama did, actually, you are losing your strategic posture. You are losing your credibility. If you ignore the harassment of American vessels by Iranian boats in the Strait of Hormuz, you are losing credibility. If you don't respond aggressively for the Houthis provocations trying to target an American destroyer in the Strait of Bab el-Mandeb. 3 times. Surface to sea missiles. Launched by the Houthis, but Iranian made, Iranian weapons provided to the Houthis. Trying to target the USS Mason, American destroyer in the Strait of Bab el-Mandeb. Missing it because of defensive measures taken by the destroyer. Not because of something else. But not responding in a way that it will create an impact, first of all on Iran, but the other parties in the region. This is America. You're losing credibility. And there is a linkage between losing credibility in North Korea and losing credibility regarding Iran, losing credibility in the Middle East. And this is the case with what I claim, and that's why I published an article recently in the INSS, proposing a grand strategy for the United States, with all modesty. I'm quite furious from the Trump-Putin understanding regarding Syria. I feel furious. The impact of 59 Tomahawk missiles launched by the United States. As a response to Bashar al-Assad crossing the red line of using chemical weapons against his own civilians, was a great impact. Not just against Bashar al-Assad. Iranians started to rethink about their policy and strategy in the region. It was a boost to the Sunni Arab regimes. We were furious from Obama association with Iran, using Iran as part of the solution, because Iran was ready to fight ISIS. Big deal. And the Trump administration, until the Trump-Putin understanding, took certain steps in Syria, which demonstrated determination. The interception of the Syrian Sukhoi on the way to launch airstrike against the Sunni militias trained and supported by the United States. It was an impact. Intercepting Iranian drone on the way to attack, an armed drone, to attack another Sunni militia or a training camp near Tanaf, was intercepted by U.S. aircraft. Another impact, the visit to Riyadh. I'm now with the Sunnis, not with Iran. It's not enough, because what we see now after the Trump-Putin understanding is actually going back to the way that the United States would be seen by the parties in the region in the time of Obama administration. So even minor steps have the ability to build your strategic posture by exercising determination, which might enhance your ability and leverages to press such a regime like in Tehran or in North Korea as well. Nevertheless, nowadays, and especially after the very good speech delivered by President Trump, what is my recommendation, and I believe there is understanding in the INSS regarding recommendation? First of all, it should be very clear. By one way or another, the military nuclear in Iran should be stopped. First of all, this is an Israeli policy. And I believe that we have the credibility, going back to the Iraqi president, the Syrian president, and of course, the Iranian challenge is ahead of us. And that's what actually President Trump said in his speech. Now, we have to materialize it. What should be done? My recommendation is not to open the deal. By opening the deal, actually, we are going to spend and to waste time in arguing disputes with other parties of the P5+1, which is useless. There are enough reasons to press this regime. Because of hard evidence violations, of UN Security Council resolutions like the proliferation of arms. The shipments to the Houthis in Yemen, it's well known to the intelligence community, comes from Bandar Abbas to Oman, and then from Oman to Yemen. Hard evidence on a daily basis. They try to make it by ships directly to Yemen, they fail. So they do it now via Oman. Iranian shipments to Hezbollah in Lebanon. Iranian facilities in Lebanon producing, manufacturing missiles. Iranian know-how and Iranian money to the military wing of Hamas, to the Palestinian Islamic Jihad, as Iranian proxy. Hard evidence. The Iranian activities to undermine the Sunni regimes in Bahrain, in Saudi Arabia. Hard evidence. Terror infrastructure in 5 continents. Hard evidence. So there is enough reasons just regarding the proliferation of arms and terror to impose sanctions. Even American bilateral sanctions. Even. Then to try to get on board the other parties, to include UN Security Council members and the P5+1, then the missile project. Hard evidence. You don't have to open the deal. You can impose sanctions now. And if you wish, another reason, human rights. Human rights violation in Iran. Hard evidence on a daily basis. So what I propose is, yes, to try to rehabilitate the achievement of 2013, in which the regime, or actually Khamenei, came to the table on his knees because of, first of all, the crippling economic stuff. Then he done behave himself, political isolation, credible military option by either minor activities, but you have to show determination, political stomach, to exercise this leverage, to include the military option. For Israel, is to have a better coordination with the US administration. We lost it in the time of Obama because of certain reasons. Better open channels to coordinate activities, of course, sharing intelligence, even more than that, and to be on the same page regarding what should be done in any case, whether it is during the 10, 15 years of time of the validity of the agreement, or after it, by agreeing that by one way or another, we both, the United States, Israel, as well as other elements. I know the British and the French criticism regarding the deal between the interim agreement to Vienna. They were very critical to the way that the United States administration managed the very bad deal. So to have all these parties on board in order to reach the goal, which is not to allow Iran any military nuclear capability, and even not to allow Iran rogue activities in the Middle East and beyond. Thank you.